The Unprofessional Boxing Podcast. If you wanted professional, you came to the wrong f***ing place.
Everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Unprofessional Boxing Podcast. My name is Boxer Gray. I'm eating chips into the mic. It's my last chip. You gotta deal with it. It's unprofessional. Deal. It's another episode. We've made it like to episode 4, I think. I'm very happy about this. And we couldn't do it without the support of you, the listeners. So thank you for continuing to listen and give us encouragement about this wonderful podcast project I'm doing. With my guy, Tim Boxeo, who I'll introduce in a sec. But if you haven't already, give us follows on Twitter, BOXRECGREY, Tim Boxeo as well. And just continue to download the podcast and listen to it where you can listen to podcasts. You know where to listen to podcasts. Spotify, Google Play. Yeah, I don't need to list them. You get the point. But thank you for your support. Yeah, this week, we're gonna change it up. We got a special guest. We got a surprise guest. And let me tell you, if you're not in the Tim Boxeo Discord, you wouldn't know. You know, you're gonna find these things out ahead of time because Panic Gray's gonna forget he's got to record in 30 minutes. He's gotta let everybody know about it. So if you're in the Tim Boxeo Discord, you would know that this week, in addition to my guy Tim Boxeo, Tim, first of all, how are you doing?
I'm doing great, dude. What a diva, eating chips as we start the podcast.
Absolutely.
This is great.
I had one chip left. Had to do it. So Tim,
this is awesome.
Got Tim here and our special guest. The guy in this crew, the unofficial third man. If we had to have a third guy, it would be this guy all the way. Someone I consider a friend, a genius, who makes a living in boxing. God bless him. Corey Erdman is here. How are you doing, man?
Man, I don't know how I managed to make a living in boxing for this long. I'm really lucky. You know, I should be the one eating chips at this point and just like yelling at club boxing. But
yeah,
thanks for having me, guys. I am also probably. I probably have the most prodigious collection of Tim Boxeo merchandise in the world at this point. I think I have every item. So yeah, I am thrilled to be here.
Damn. Yeah. Let's also, before we get going, a little housekeeping. Tim, you opened up a store, didn't you? Let's talk about Tim Boxeo things real quick.
So the cool thing about the store, you know, I've got some stuff with my logo on it, but then I have the Everyday is for Boxing t-shirt in there with that stanza. Helped me design and gave away some t-shirts to some folks. But the cool thing about the store, I just have everything on there in cost. So they print it on demand. I don't make a dime. I don't want to make any money off the shirts. Come on. It would be more of a pain in the ass for me to do the taxes on all of it, to be honest. So it's all just in there at cost, as cheap as I could possibly do it. So check it out. The links in my profile in my bio.
Yeah, man. And you're also doing a newsletter now, I saw. What's up with that? Tell us the deal.
Yeah, so really quick on that, you guys remember I did a Patreon for like 3 months where I wanted to put some additional content club boxing related, and then it just became hard to keep up with the pace, and I couldn't look myself in the mirror taking money from people to do that. So I just transferred all this to Substack. The link's in my bio as well. And I'm just, you know, when I can, I'll put additional stuff out in Substack. It's all free. You don't have to pay for it, and that way you can get a little something once in a while, and I won't feel as tethered to the computer. And hopefully I'll stay consistent with it. I mean, I think I will, and then hopefully enjoy it.
Yeah, you guys should definitely go buy Tim Boxeo merchandise. Go to the newsletter, because if I know Tim, he's going to make that newsletter. It's going to be beefy. It's going to have lots of content, and it's going to have a lot of interesting fights that we may not talk about on this podcast, because listen, we only have about an hour to cover things on here. So I'm sure there's tons of different little tidbits that we're going to miss on the show that Tim's going to realize, oh, that's great for the newsletter. So that's
Like Prince Patel. I prefer girthy than beefy, but
good grief.
I'll let you take it.
Hey-o.
I'm here for the next 45 minutes. Yep. Go ahead.
All right. Let's start real quick, guys. Friday night. This is where my Friday night boxing viewing Really started and ending with a little show on Fight TV. Shout out to the good people at Fight. This took place in Vegas. It was a card called the Sons of the Legends. And the first thing that just jumped out at me, Corey, I'm gonna throw this one to you. Are you aware of the guy that fights under the name Roberto Duran Jr.?
So I know that there is a person who exists with that name, but as far as his background, I'm entirely unfamiliar.
What if I told you he's not related to Roberto Duran whatsoever?
So that wouldn't shock me, because we do this all the time, because we like go through just kind of like old Box Rec profiles, and especially like from the turn of the century up to like 1950. It was a very popular thing to do, to just name yourself after a historical fighter.
Yes.
Like whoever, and he'd be like, yeah, Jack Johnson III is fighting this weekend. And he'd be like 0-1, it would never fight again. So I love that we're reviving this age-old tradition of just like pretending that you're the son of someone that you are not related to whatsoever.
Yeah, it's a phenomenal like grift. And to do it on a show with actual sons of world champions, It's confusing, and I love it. That's what I like. I like things to be.
So here's my question, though: did he fool the promoters into thinking this was the son of Roberto Duran? Did they just think that he's close enough and like kind of part of the theme that they just let it happen?
So his manager is the manager of Mackenzie Morrison, who we'll be talking about shortly. So I think they know what's happening, but they were like, "Well, it's close enough." Let's throw him on the card. But he got outpointed by a 19-year-old from Missouri. So shout out
pretty
to
handily. Pretty handily, by
pretty
the way.
Pretty handily, yeah. It was not a close fight at all. So Arturo Moreno, 19 years old from Springfield, Missouri, comes to Las Vegas. And, you know, they're very strict in how they matchmake guys in that state. Like, they will reject a lot of things. So there's probably not a lot of circumstances they let Moreno fight, even fair or not, as it may be. But it was just nice to see a guy like that getting a win in Vegas. Made me really happy, even if it's a smaller show.
Our guy Smitty was on the color commentary, and there was at least one or two comments of, oh, geez, doesn't he look just like the father, you know? So they were either in on it or oblivious to it. I'm not sure which.
I have to ask him if I see him in Canastota this year at the Hall of Fame, if he knows the deal. Because I feel like I think Smitty would know the deal, and he's just kind of working the marks. But you never know. I'm not 100% sure. Before we get to our main event in my story, did either of you watch, I assume both you are aware of guys like Gerald McClellan Jr., the son of Gerald McClellan, who's like 33, so turning pro late, and Keith Hunter, Mike the Bounty Hunter's son. I wasn't really overly impressed with either guy, to be honest, even though they both won. And then Sharif Rahman, who's one of Haseem Rahman's two children, was on this card, fought as well. And yeah, I don't know, Tim, were you impressed with any, like overly impressed with any of these guys? It just seemed like kind of workmanlike wins, you know, like they got the job done.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Nobody that I added to my watch list in Box Rec, I'll leave it at that.
No. But one fight guy, the main event was very near and dear to my heart, because I do love heavyweights and I love sons of heavyweights. And we got to see James Mackenzie Morrison, one of many unknown number of sons or daughters that Tommy Morrison left the world with, left us. But yeah, he was in the main event fighting Haseem Rahman Jr. So it was 19-0-2 Morrison against 12-0 Rahman Jr. And both these guys really hadn't fought anybody. And I don't know how you felt, Tim, but I may or may not have taken a substance that put me on another realm of existence while watching this fight. And I was just in heaven watching Haseem Rahman Jr. just beautifully pump that jab off the ropes for four rounds. And I said, guys, this is going to be a master boxing class. And that bet that I may or may not have put on Haseem Rahman Jr., I was very confident was going to hit. But Tim, everything kind of changed in the fifth round, didn't it?
Imagine, Corey, the level of degenerate you have to be to utter the words, I thought I was in heaven watching Haseem Rahman Jr.
Well, I mean, I've probably said that out loud as well, because I definitely watched one of his fights. It wasn't at in Tijuana, so it wasn't at Big Punch. It was in like Matamoros, and he fought like a 300-pound Mexican heavyweight, and I remember probably saying something like that, and maybe being in the same state that Gray described himself being in as well.
It wasn't Matamoros. Good memory.
So, okay, there we go.
Gray, you're right. I mean, it was like the fourth round, somewhere around that time frame that I realized, because I thought for sure Rockman Jr. was going to score the knockout.
Yep.
Because I've seen Morrison fight a bunch of times. He's just so raw, and he's 31 years old. I mean, it's tough, man. Like,
imagine a guy plodding forward, and he's landing a good hook occasionally, but he's getting hit with 10 punches in response.
Yeah, exactly. And he was taking them.
Yep.
And then that cartoon light bulb went off over my head in like the third round, and I was like, oh shit, this is just going to be whoever gasses first. And and that's basically exactly what happened.
In the fifth round, Haseem Rahman gasses spectacularly, and Morrison starts catching him with hooks, knocking him down once. Rahman beats the count and is stopped along the ropes, perhaps a quick stoppage, but completely kills whatever high I was on at that moment, and brings me down to a cold, chilling reality that my bet was absolutely demolished in about 30 seconds. So shout out to James McKenzie Morrison. He's still undefeated at 20-0-2, getting the fifth round stoppage. But yeah, like that, I would say the talent level that we watched between those two heavyweights, not far from the top 10 guys.
Yeah, that doesn't matter though, because no. Like, I mean, it certainly doesn't matter to us because we'll watch anything. But I mean, in like the broader sense of things, like, I mean, first of all, James McKenzie Morrison kind of leans into his familial ties more than Trey Lippe does. Mm-hmm. And now with the book that just came out and the movie that is forthcoming about Tommy Morrison, like, he'll get one opportunity to really cash in. Yes. He'll fight on something above a streaming pay-per-view. Like, that will happen, I would say, in the next 12 to 18 months.
He's going to be, you're 100% right. And I would say, I'd imagine there are heavyweights out here that are going to be on a lot of guys that we know that are coming off of long layoffs. And maybe they need a name for their comeback. And why not go to somebody with the famous last name that's undefeated? Makes a lot of sense to me. So 100% on board with you, Corey. I think you're dead on. I really have nothing else to say about Friday. So Tim, you want to kind of take it from here and tell us about what your Saturday viewing was like, if you had anything exciting going on in the afternoon?
Yeah, no. Saturday afternoon was a complete shit show. There was nothing. Like, I was in a level of boxing depression that I haven't been in some time. I was just, imagine me, because you know my thoughts on close your ears, Corey, on DAZN. But I just didn't want to. I mean, I was sitting there waiting for the DAZN undercard to start for Taylor Serrano. That's how bad it was.
Wow. That is, I'm with you. I also did not watch anything.
What about BKFC? Hold on. What about, you didn't tune in for BKFC?
I watched BKFC after the fact, and I just want to shout out the fact that there is no way that Joe Riggs could be possibly medically cleared to fight just from his, like, I was worried about him. That's all I'm going to say.
Oh, yeah. And, but the highlight of the night is DAZN veteran Billy Wagner,
yes,
who has a great head of hair that you would appreciate, Gray, scoring a wicked knockout. Like that, a beautiful uppercut knockout on par with Fury White, I would say.
Probably the best fighter in Montana currently.
Definitely.
I think he's actually a pretty serviceable pro boxer. And I think the light bulb went off in him in his corner after that knockout he got. He knocked out this guy in the first round. Like, I have a feeling we'll see him again in bare knuckle because he's pretty good. Like, it was actually better than the skill level you see on shows like that. So I think we'll see more Billy Wagner knocking guys out of Montana and hopefully Joe Riggs.
Yeah, hopefully no more Joe Riggs. And you don't often see in bare knuckle. Like, it does happen, but I would say it's in the lower percentile of the knockouts that you see that are like Wagner's knockout, where you kind of have like a super clean punch. Like he steps back and he lands a flush uppercut. A lot of bare knuckle knockouts, they kind of happen in a frenzy, or they happen when they're in a clinch because they can dirty box a little bit. But like Wagner landing just a flush, pure, flat out knockout, like that was something to watch with no gloves.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. I want to go into, so Tim, I want to go into the DAZN card. I know your feelings on DAZN, but we did watch it. And I know your feelings on big shows. But Corey was in New York. My guy, Corey, you were there. So
I was.
You want to just kind of give us the overall, I'll let you kind of take over. Like kind of give me your feelings about being an MSG for this card. I know you've been to plenty of shows, but just kind of like talk about, you know, how was it? Did you enjoy it out there? It seemed like a pretty wild atmosphere. And I definitely am guilty of ducking out. I could have gone, was burnt out. So feel free to put me on blast for not being there. I wish I was there with you. But yeah, tell us about how it went.
Yeah, I mean, you completely blew it because it was the loudest fight atmosphere I've ever been in. Wow. It was an energy that I've never felt in a boxing venue before. And for good reason, you know, it felt, you know, when we see big fights that we've kind of been waiting for a long time, you feel that energy in the crowd that's kind of like, it's that anticipation, right? It's that you know, what you felt when, like, Mayweather and Pacquiao were in the ring. You know, just using that as a comparison. Where there's that anticipation. We've been waiting so long, and finally this is happening. In this case, you have not just the anticipation of the fight happening, but waiting all this time for women to get this kind of slot in this kind of venue on this kind of broadcast platform. And then you have two very rabid national fan bases that are also in the house. And that combination of things just created just a really special environment. You know, there was a special kind of emotion in the ring, or in the arena, excuse me, and in the ring as well. It was like a wall of sound that was always around you at all times. Like I was inches away from the ring and couldn't hear the bell. I could never hear the 10-second indicator. I don't know that the fighters could hear either of them either. It was kind of up to Michael Griffin to use like hand signals to tell them. And you know, the fight is obviously what we saw. It was incredible as well. But what I'll always remember is what it felt like in the arena that night.
Yeah, I watched the fight on mute, because my wife may or may not have been on the same substance as I was on Friday night and was doing art and wanted to blast the music. So I had to watch it on mute, but that was the rules. I was allowed to watch it on TV as long as I had it on mute. So watching it without commentary was a very different experience than others I had probably, but it looked like a great fight, man. Like I was impressed, like high level. They both gave it their all. I was blown away. Like I didn't need the volume or people to tell me how good the fight was. I could tell it was a great fight. And I was regretting not being there. And I think that the scorecards were fine. I think it was a hard fight to score, guys. Like, I don't know about you, but like sitting there, I'm like, man, these rounds, it depends on what you liked more, Tim. What do you, I mean, how did you feel about it?
Yeah, the first thing I wanted to share before I answer that question, Gray, is, and Corey, you nailed this. I mean, the three of us have been to the big fights, and I'm sure most everybody listening has as well. If you haven't, it's a lifetime experience that you have to have. What's so often missed, though, when you watch at home and on television is what Corey described, is that anticipation and just the electricity. This was one of those rare fights where I felt like that came through the television. Like you could feel that sitting at watching at home. That's how crazy and electric that atmosphere was at Madison Square Garden. And yeah, thankfully the fight also in the ring just lived up to expectations completely. I've long told my wife that I think women are far tougher than men for a whole laundry list of reasons. Us guys are like a bunch of babies and you know, women are just tough as nails. I think I mentioned that a couple shows ago too, because bare knuckle proves that to us almost every weekend. And these two ladies just were both tough as hell. And I'm with you. I think, you know, a boxing weekend isn't going to go by with somebody being outraged at one of the scorecards. So I kind of let most of that go in one ear and out the other, especially on boxing Twitter. I thought the rounds were difficult to score, and it was a little bit of a flavor of the week. I think, you know, the round where Katie almost went down was a pretty clear round for her. Other than that, pretty difficult. I mean, I have zero problem with the 97-93 scorecard. Honestly, zero problem. Yeah. That was pretty close to what my scorecard was. And, I think the right fighter won. And I think it was close. I'm okay with saying, you know, maybe my scorecard was off by a round or two. But, it wasn't robbery like at 97-93. And I just think it was a fantastic fight that shouldn't be overshadowed by anything. And just stand on its own.
I agree. Corey, I'd imagine that there's probably paper, you know, work already in place for a rematch, and they'll do it somewhere else. Like, it makes sense to do it again somewhere in another big arena.
Yeah, I think that it seems like a near certainty that it would happen again, because they're kind of, at least in terms of, I mean, number one, the fight is so good that you kind of just have to do it again, and you want to do it again, but also the reasonable opponents for either woman at this point, they're kind of waiting for them to come up from 130, like the Michaela Mayers and Alicia Baumgartners and whoever else. Like, they're kind of waiting for them to get done with one another and then hop up to 135. And then we have a new set of fights that could be tremendous too. But yeah, it just seems logical to do it. And whether they do it in Ireland in a monstrous stadium, or they bring it back to Madison Square Garden and just try and, you know, capture that magic once again, I'm cool with either decision. I think both would be really neat. I think it would be tremendous if Katie would get that opportunity to be able to fight in Ireland finally. But if not, or if there's just too much money on the table to bring it back to MSG, I would love to have that feeling again, and I'd love to be there a second time.
Yeah, and I'll actually remember to show up. I just want to quickly mention that shout out to Liam Smith with a 10th round stoppage over future failed politician Jesse Vargas. But I want to say that probably the guy that stole the show for me on the undercard, Tim, is a guy you talked about last week, really liking. And I think he sold me on his performance. Amo Williams taking care of Chordal Booker in under a round.
He's the real deal, isn't he? I mean, the way he puts his punches together, he's just so sharp and accurate. And his variety offense is very good. I mean, gosh damn, I'm really high on that kid. I hope he stays busy, because I like to see him a little bit more frequently, like every other month. Let's get him fighting and keep him moving forward. What do you think about Amon Williams, Corey?
Yeah, I mean, I thought that was going to be a really tough fight for him, because Cordell is a really good fighter, a really slick fighter, but it just hasn't been the same since he had that Achilles injury. And I think that he got trapped on the ropes, yeah.
I totally forgot about that ACL injury. Angel reminded me, and it's like, dude, Cordell looked like a totally, honestly, a lot different than I remember. He didn't have the speed.
It just wasn't the same. And once he got trapped on the ropes, like, Ambo's just too explosive to be able to just bob and weave and roll with all those punches. And Cordell's very good at it, but not against someone like Ammo. Also, Ammo goes everywhere with a really adorable dog. He has like a purebred Airedale Terrier that he brings everywhere with him, and he's really cute. So that's a great gimmick. Him and Montana Love have the same gimmick going right now.
I have more dogs at weigh-ins. And one more guy that I thought stole the show. I'll say, we give a lot of the boxing Twitter give Brits a hard time, obviously, but I thought Galal Yafai in his second pro bout really beat up Miguel Cartagena, a tough Philly guy. I've seen him on shows before. I figured Yafai would win, Tim, but he frankly bulldozed him in two rounds. Like, it was a beatdown. It wasn't close.
He did it. He did. And his offensive attack is obviously, you know, really good. The guy never stops punching. The thing that would have me concerned, and, you know, he's got, what, two fights now? So, yep. You know, it's not like he's going into a world title fight in his next fight. But, and maybe it was the quality of the opponent, but he just stands right in the pocket and just lets his hands go. and he does not move at all. Like, there's no angles. there's no head movement. Yeah. It's very Mexican like in his attack.
I kind of love watching him though. Like I think, you know, Corey, you would agree that being 29, he's late. I mean, he's had a long amateur career. Like, they have to probably get him in a world title fight pretty soon if they want to get a return on him.
Oh yeah, but and I think they know that, and I think Galal knows that too. I think that he doesn't want to stick around too long. Sorry, I shouldn't say he doesn't want to stick around too long. I don't think he wants to waste his time with gimme fights for all that long, because yeah, he is 29. He's an Olympic gold medalist. He was in the World Series of Boxing, so he's effectively had pro fights against better fighters than the ones he's facing right now. But listen, this is really impressive. Like, having 210 rounds to start your career, there's not too many guys get to do that. We see that a little more often in places like Thailand, or like Eric Rosa, one of the minimum weight champions right now, yep, did the same thing. But other than guys like that, it's guys like Lomachenko, right? You need to be accomplished enough as an amateur and old enough that the commission says, yeah, we're okay with that. But at weights like the one he's at, you could see him fighting for a world title within 8 fights. Like, I don't think that's unreasonable for him at all.
Well, let's see, Corey, what if we see where he's at right now, and maybe next fight we see him against Maruti Talani?
I mean, would they want to take a risk like that? Like, I mean, it's...
Cause well, how do you think that fight would go?
Oh, boy. That would
feel... Because Talani's what? He's got to be 40. He's probably 40, right? 39, yeah. Maybe?
Yeah. You could see someone like Yafai just being too much for Mithilani right now, who's aging, and he could just get kind of bulldozed, maybe. But, you know, But I'm saying that now, but like last fight, I thought he would beat Sonny Edwards, and he didn't come anywhere close to beating Sonny Edwards. Yeah. So my read of where Mithilani is right now is maybe a little bit skewed. I would say they probably wouldn't do something like that right away, like maybe in a couple fights, but like let's not downplay what happened, because like Cartagena would have been an acceptable opponent for someone that was 20-0, you know, let alone 1-0. So I want to give Yafai his flowers for what he did on Saturday.
Absolutely. All right, guys, I want to shift gears, if that's okay with you, Tim, to this week. Got a couple things on the schedule that just bring a smile to my face. I want to talk about heavyweights as usual. There's a heavyweight in the United States that he doesn't have a great looking record, but I want to pay tribute to him because he is like, he will fight pretty much anybody, anytime, anywhere. And he's a guy that I think it's avoided a lot of times because I call him, he's the prospect. You know, he can ruin a prospect's career pretty quickly. Terrell Jamal Woods, who is 27-50-9, will be fighting Thursday on Fight TV in Pasadena, Texas. This is part of that Fight Plus package that Tim has brought up before. And he's taking on an 8-0 Mexican heavyweight who has fought on probably that card in Matamoros that Corey was mentioning earlier while he was on Substances. Probably was on the next card. And he's fighting Terrell Woods in an 8-rounder. But Tim, I know you've had to have seen Woods fight many, many times because I know you're, you know, on your streams. But yeah, you want to give our viewers and kind of a quick rundown of Mr. Woods' abilities.
So probably the best way I could summarize Woods quickly is he's from Arkansas, if I'm not mistaken.
Right.
And the long forgotten heavy U.S. heavyweight in Arkansas was J.D. Chapman, who retired for a good 12 years undefeated, had all kinds of smoke in the press, 6'5", huge guy, and took a 4-rounder against Terrell Woods, and Woods went in there and just beat him up. I mean, I thought at the time it was probably a 4-0 fight. I think it was ended up being 3-1. And Woods is the type of guy where it just depends on the day. Like if he feel he's a big guy, he's about 250. He weighed in earlier today, I think at 255 for this one, 6'3", 6'4". He doesn't have great power, but if he just decides to fight, and then I think combined with the fact that if he sees a little blood in the water and thinks he can win, he is going to be a handful for anybody. And the guy he's going up against, I'm not terribly familiar with, but Rolando Soto is, gentlemen, the current WBC Fekerbox Bridgerweight champion.
And he weighed in today.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
He weighed in at 218 today.
Active in the Bridgerweight rankings.
Is the title on the line? Like, could we see Terrell Jamal Woods like work his way up for a shot against Oscar Rivas? Is that what you're suggesting, Tim?
I think Terrell
25 pounds.
I think Woods' ability to make 218 left him is it 218? I don't know. Left him years ago.
First of all, I remember watching that JD Chapman fight with you. I mean, virtually with you. I think, you know, we had one of those like really greasy like VLC player streams going, you know, like real like, you know, 2011 era type streaming. And I remember watching that fight. I've watched so many Terrell Jamal Woods fights over the years because, yeah, he fights everyone. And I think, like, when you look at what he's done, like, the best way to kind of categorize his skill level, when he faces, like, the recognizable journeyman, when he faces, like, the Dominic Gwynns or, like, the Alexander Ustinovs, like, the guys that are brought in to lose that have nicer-looking records, he basically fights them on even terms or almost beats them. So he's basically as good as those guys, but just happens to have a really upside down record. Like, am I going too far if I were to call him kind of like the Marion Wilson of our generation?
Yeah, yeah, he's the closest you're going to get for sure. Good chin, like you said, goes rounds with heavyweights that we know and heard of, and sometimes gets wins. Like, I'm looking through his record. Like, I mean, this is a guy that's fought Michael Hunter, Eric Molina, majority decision loss, Kevin Johnson, close unanimous decision loss. Big Bang Zhang, who's fighting this weekend to get him out in two rounds in nearby Quincy, Massachusetts, back when I was living in Mass. He did lose to Tyshawn Dong, though. I don't know how that's possible.
He's fought everyone. Trevor Bryan, Konaki.
Jesus.
He's got everyone.
Yeah.
I haven't thought about Tyshawn Dong in a long time. Like, we're going to have to do an episode that's just let's remember some guys.
Names. Tyshawn Dong will play footage, Corey, of his WWE like tryout, and then he got cut like 2 months after
immediately.
He got signed because he didn't want to do it. He hadn't taken notes.
Holy he made the shit. Right.
Vince loves 7 foot heavyweights.
here's a little nugget for you. I guess I didn't realize this. Do you know who he fought his pro debut against?
I'll have to look. But let us know.
In 2011? None other than God's Power. Duradola.
Wow.
When Duradola first came over and was being moved through the upper Midwest and Midwest club circuit, they matched him on his pro debut his second pro fight with a pro debuting Terrell Jamal Woods.
Did you attend that? Like, I just pulled up his box rack now because now I'm really interested. Did you attend that show? Seems like right up your alley at Bartle Hall in Kansas City.
God, I wish. Oh my God, I can feel blood rushing just talking about it.
No promoter listed. That's great. That sounds like a pretty packed show. Jesus. All right. So as we move along here, my God, Tim, let's talk about what do I want to talk about for Friday here? There's bare knuckle. Oh yeah, this BKFC card. Corey, this is where you come in. Because this was insane when we first talked about this fight. Very canceled former WWE wrestler Jax, what the hell is his name? Gentleman Jack Gallagher.
Yes.
Fighting an opponent that you want. I'm just trying to remember his name here. He's fighting. What the hell was his? What the heck's his name? You want to just tell us about the guy he's supposed to fight? I'm not sure if you remember his name, but Brandon Lambert.
Oh, Brandon Lambert. Yeah. So is he actually fighting Brandon Lambert anymore? Because I don't see that listed on BoxRec.
No, it got literally changed this morning.
Yeah. So that's the point. Like, if I recall, Brandon Lambert has had like three different brain hemorrhages and has said as much on camera. And so he's been, listen, I'm not going to say what show, but I remember he was scheduled for a fight and I was talking to the matchmaker and I was like, oh, that's weird that he got sanctioned with a history of traumatic brain injuries. And they were like, wait, what? And he was no longer on that show. I'm going to imagine that the same thing has happened this time around.
I will say
that he's been sanctioned since that in more than one place. So it's not like his career's over or anything like that. People are letting this man fight.
Yeah, they are. And didn't he say that he believed that CBD cured his brain hemorrhages or something like that? Just some crazy shit.
Or they just haven't happened since. It's not like, because they happened, you know, you can't erase them. But yes, all because of CBD oil, they haven't happened since.
So yeah, that was going to be your Friday. Former canceled pro wrestler against a guy who is an advocate for CBD fixing your brain hemorrhages.
Jack Gallagher like lives on a houseboat and smokes weed all day now, right? Isn't that like, that's what he does?
That's usually what you do when you get fucking canceled. Yeah, that sounds about right. Like that's
one option that you have.
That's
one option.
But like really leaning into the sleazy, like Florida lifestyle, like living on a house.
Yeah. You know, not that I want to like give credit to someone who did like what he did, but at least in Jack Gallagher's case, he was like, "Yes, I did that, and I will willingly like leave. You're not going to hear from me."
He didn't try and fight it. He actually, his reward was getting immediately fired and
immediately fired. Yeah,
and there are people in that company that have done the same thing, probably multiple times, and they're still there. So go.
Yeah, yeah. Headlining WrestleMania. Yeah.
Headlining WrestleMania. Good shit. Good stuff. Yeah, so there's your Friday. Tim, is there anything else you want to mention about Friday real quick, or can I move on?
Just a real quick rewind to Thursday in Toronto on DAZN, because
this is on DAZN.
We got Thursday on DAZN.
Yes, that's right.
Our friend here will be delivering us the action.
Oh shit!
I'm very, very interested in that main event: Brian Acosta against 21-year-old Canelito Garcia.
This is a tight fight.
It's a very good fight, Corey. What do you think about the main event?
That's a great main event, and I've really enjoyed seeing Brian Acosta up close over the last little while. He's in the same camp as Juan Francisco Estrada and Miguel Burchelt. And to me, he's just a really aesthetically pleasing, slick boxer. He put a real beating on Lamberto Macias in his last fight back in March, which is in the same place that this card will be at. And now he gets a chance to headline it and get a little publicity out of it and get a little exposure. This kind of quietly was put together. This is the Lee Baxter promotion show that's going to be aired on DAZN globally. My hope is that this will kind of be a part of like kind of in the same vein as those Thursday night Golden Boy shows, where maybe it'll like they've signed a deal. So in theory, this is not a one and done. There'll be subsequent shows. And maybe this also opens the doors for other promoters to kind of get in the action. Some midweek fights of this caliber give fighters like this some exposure that otherwise they wouldn't get because they're not signed to Matchroom or whatever. It's cool. This is the first time that DAZN has ever aired a show from Canada. And, you know, I get to go 10 minutes from my house and go call it. So I'm excited about this one.
Dude, that's awesome, Corey. I apologize. I had no idea DAZN was fine. Mean,
no,
like...
no. And it's been quiet. It's been very, you know, kind of a soft launch, I would say, too. So you're not you shouldn't feel bad about not knowing about it.
No, I'm excited for you, man, because I remember we talked about like privately pre-pandemic, like your hope that they would do shows in Canada. So like, I know this has been a long time coming for you. So I'm I'm thrilled for you, man. And I know Lee Baxter, not to pull the curtain back too far, but I know he did a show with Lou in Detroit a couple weeks ago, Lou DiBella. So like you said, I hope that there's some relationships that can be built, because I think we could see a lot of guys that don't get a lot of TV exposure. This could be another avenue. That'd be awesome.
Yeah, and to round out the card, Lee, who's an Irish prospect who kind of took a little bit of a fluky loss to a journeyman during the pandemic, he's on that card. Stephen Wilcox, a super lightweight who has a record, like a 22-3-1 record. You can see him as kind of like a B-side for a name at 140 pounds if he can do something impressive in this fight. And then Moze Awadi, who is a really, really talented amateur in the Canadian system, suffered an injury and took a loss. So he's 2-1. And he'll get some exposure on this show as well. So, yeah, these are the types of guys that just don't get these kind of looks without these kinds of broadcasts. So I'm just happy for Canadian fighters to have a platform like this.
Absolutely, man. Oh, no, this is great. Yeah, shout out to DAZN for expanding to Canada. Finally, I remember. Yeah, this has been a long time coming for you, man. So this is awesome. But I wanted to... if there's anything else about Thursday, Corey, there was another show in Canada. While we're still on the Canada run here, I wanted to get your thoughts on, because I know this is a guy you called a couple of his fights ago. Ryan Rosicky is fighting in Nova Scotia against a two-time Olympian from Argentina, Yamel Peralta. And I actually think that's a pretty, like, for you know, that's a solid fight, man.
It's a solid fight. It's a dangerous main event for Rosicky. And as far as I know, I think there's going to be a pay-per-view stream of this, and it'll also be on TYC Sports in Argentina, obviously, because of Peralta. That's a dangerous fight for Rosicky. I think that Rosicky exceeded a lot of expectations against Oscar Rivas, but I think it's a fair question to ask. Like, number one, he took a lot of punishment in that fight. How much did that take out of him? And number two, is that his peak? And, you know, can someone like Peralta come in and pull the upset on the road? Like, I'm excited for this one, too. It's too bad that I'll be busy as this is live, but I want to watch it after. But I know that our good pal McIntosh Ross is going to be live tweeting all throughout it. So definitely check his feed. He'll get you covered on that fight.
That's awesome. And there's a show in Brampton, too. Wow. Ontario.
Yeah. Canada just on fire with these shows.
So I was going to ask you, so is this like the beginning? Like, are some of these commissions starting to do like open shows to the public now? Like, it seems like they're kind of getting back to Canada.
Yeah. So all these are going to be fully attended. To my knowledge, there's no restrictions in any of the other provinces for that right now. So, So I think there's a lot of promoters that have just kind of been waiting and saving their cash, and now kind of have this influx of shows and want to get guys busy that weren't able to fight during the deadliest grips of the pandemic.
Nice. So Tim, I want to go on. So there's a show in Sonora on Saturday that was supposed to take place a few weeks ago, but your boy here was filing some paperwork on behalf of the American Boxing Federation yesterday for a title fight taking place on Saturday. So shout out to 18-year-old Dana Bolanos, who's going to defend her championship against 2-2-1 Linda Contreras. I hope you can catch a stream of that, Tim, but I just wanted to let you know we're doing the ABF is strong in Sonora, my friend.
Well, thank you. You threw a softball up to me there, because I think I included this in one of my first Substack posts. So go subscribe to my Substack.
Hell yeah.
Because Dana Ponce Bolanos, AKA Tuzita, 18 years old. She's a really fun fighter to watch. She's a brawler, man. She just comes forward and just throws as many punches as possible. Really tough, tough fighter. So I'm looking forward to seeing that one. Yep. We'll be able to watch that one on the prestigious fight.tv.
FIGHT. Not our friends.
Oh, okay.
It's a different fight.
So I was going to ask, is this one of those Sonora shows that's at the resort that's along the water? Like that one that we watched where there's a segment where Smitty goes shopping for a shirt.
Corey?
Is it in the same venue?
Corey? Don't ask questions. Don't ask questions I can't answer. I have no idea where this fucking show is taking place. All I know is I filed paperwork. I know it's in San Luis Rio, Colorado. That's all I know. I have no idea where this venue is. No clue.
Okay. Listen, I'm just asking because I know there's a series of fights coming up in Sonora called the World. Was it it's like the World Cup of Boxing or something like that. It's going to be on beIN Sport. Yeah, and those are going to be in Sonora in that venue along the water. So I wanted to know.
Yeah, I think the venue is. We'll find out on Saturday where it lands. Or it could be moved another 3 weeks from now. Just
we'll find out.
We'll find out. It's the magic of these shows. All right, all right. Speaking of magic, we got Thailand bare knuckle coming up on Saturday, guys.
And hell yeah!
Hell yeah! This is the second show they've done in Thailand. You can watch it on the BKFC TV streaming service. I think it's like $4.99 a month. And you get all the BKFC shows and their like offshoot stuff. They do a bunch of other, they have like a bare knuckle MMA company as well. So, one of the fighters that caught my eye and Tim's eye was a man, a former world boxing champion. Now, I'm going to just throw some stuff at you guys and blow your mind because I'm about to talk about the career of Siri Mongkol Singwansha. Siri Mongkol Singwansha. I guess I'm not sure if it's Khan or Cole. I guess he goes by both.
I've always known him as Siri Mongkol.
Siri Mongkol. I think his real name is Siri Mongkol, but whatever. He turned pro in May 1994 during the Clinton administration. First of all,
50% of the people listening to this weren't even born at that time.
Exactly.
But continue.
You're not even alive. All right. I think 8 at the time, doing the math here. He wins a world championship 2 years into his boxing career. He wins the WBC interim world bantamweight title in August of 1996, and then becomes full champion before 1997 begins. He then defends the championship 4 times in a calendar year. Remember when fighters used to do that, ladies and gentlemen? I know I sound like a shitty old-timey boxing writer. Ugh, remember when guys would fight 4 times a year? But anyway, he fought 4 times in a year, but he lost the title in Japan in 1997 to Yoshiro Tatsuyoshi. Stopped in the 7th round. Then he kind of disappears for a bit. A couple of years, he's just fighting in Thailand, and he does what a lot of fighters in Thailand do. They take 10-round bouts against kind of nondescript competition. So he's just doing this for a very long time. And then it's 2002. He's back again, but he's now fighting at 130 pounds, goes to Japan, and wins the vacant WBC super featherweight title in a second round knockout over Kengo Nagashima. Then I'm going to ask either of you two remember this fight. He defends the title once, but do you remember seeing this fight? This is 2003 in August on a Telefutura solo boxeo, very rare title fight to show on that network. He defends the title in Austin, Texas against Jesus Chavez. Did any of you watch this fight? Just curious.
Yes. I remember watching that because I also think that if I'm not mistaken, I think it was like an independent Top Rank pay-per-view also. But that's where I remember watching this fight. But maybe
shout out to the Colonel.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure the Colonel watching. I know I watched that fight.
I hate to correct you, Corey, but the independent Top Rank pay-per-view fight is coming up shortly. It is.
I'm confused. Okay.
Okay, because this was on free TV. My memory is very good. Before I went to college, I remember watching this fight free TV. Very big deal. He'll fight 2 more times, so don't worry. We're gonna come to probably what you're thinking of. But he ends up losing the world championship to Jesus Chavez, gets outpointed in a pretty competitive bout. Disappears again. I mean, goes back to Thailand, stays active. Then May 2005 comes and he pops up on an undercard of Winky Wright against Felix Trinidad. So the Colonel, this is where you might remember the Colonel coming into play. He fights Michael Clark in a WBC lightweight title eliminator So he's up to 135 pounds now. So the scale, we're at the scale watch here. He's now up to 135 pounds. And he wins this WBC title, lightweight title eliminator, and becomes number one contender. But, guys, there's a problem. He never cashes it in. He never cashes it in. And I remember, Corey, I don't know if you remember this, but I don't want to spread incorrect information, but I swear to God, I think he had a blood test issue or something like that. And they were just like, you can't fight in America. Like,
yeah. What there? It was something pretty nuts. And I forget precisely what it was, but yes. I don't want to take a guess, but like, yeah, I think it might have been like hepatitis or something.
That's what
crazy.
I know. It was something. It's been so long because again, we're talking about 2005 shit. This is how long this dude's been around. But yeah, I'm pretty sure the WBC takes away his title shot. For like hepatitis-y reasons, we'll call it. But
I was right. It was hepatitis.
It was hepatitis. Okay, perfect.
Yes. So
he does not cash in this 135 pound title shot. Instead, he goes back to Thailand, and once again stays active. He's winning fights. He's fighting at 140 pounds. But he runs into a legal problem, guys. He gets arrested for possession of methamphetamine and caffeine tablets. That I guess are just combined into one super drug. And, like many countries in Southeast Asia, if you get arrested for drugs, you're kind of fucked. Like, this isn't you'll get a fine. Like, you're getting caught with weed in, like, Philly. Like, he gets a 20-year prison sentence. Now, during this 20-year prison sentence... before he gets the 20-year prison sentence, by the way, like right before this, he fights on the Patton Malignaggi undercard. He wins an 8-round decision there. So I have a feeling that they were thinking about putting him in with somebody major if they were keeping him active on this, on a random undercard in Vegas, right? But he gets arrested for drugs, 20-year prison sentence. He starts fighting in sanctioned fights in jail, and he basically, like a lot of guys in Thailand, I read about this. They will let you out if you win like combat sports matches. Have you heard about this?
Yeah, you can fight your way out. Yeah. You can fight your way out of prison.
He fought his way out of prison, guys. He won the WBC Welterweight Asia Championship and they let him free. Because he won a WBC Asia Championship. Tim, is this like sinking? Like you're probably just like, what the fuck, right? But
well, right before winning that championship, he two fights before, he fought and won TKO3 versus Eagle. So the win versus Eagle, I think, is what projected him. Great. Two things I want to mention really quick.
Sure.
You know how BoxRec has, if once you get down in the rabbit hole, there's so many cool things you can find. And back in 2007, let me rewind just a little bit. He wins a unanimous decision 12 in December of 2007 in Muang Thong Thani, Thailand. And the referee is Steve Smolger. I thought that was fantastic.
Yes.
And then
I was
just a
say,
touch.
Oh, go ahead, Tim. Go ahead, Tim.
No, go.
I was going to say, do we not remember when Sarimonkul Singwancha was scheduled to fight Demetrius Andrade, like, in the last 5 years?
Oh, my God.
We're getting...
Well,
by the way, everyone wants to talk about, everyone's ducking boo-boo. How dare you erase the legacy of Sarimonkul Singwancha that way?
Yeah. By the way, I forgot to mention, before he got arrested, Singwancha is also just beating up K-1 guys in South Korea doing kickboxing. Let's not forget that. So he's doing fucking K-1 on the side while doing boxing. So this guy is just a combat sports, just he'll take anything on. So he gets
the last nugget I wanted to mention before you continue is
sure.
Sometimes you have to go back to the 1920s to find little lines in BoxRec like this one. So right, you mentioned
I know what you're
him
say.
Taking you do, right? Yeah. You mentioned him taking back the title in 2005 in the MGM Grand at the WBC lightweight title eliminator that he didn't cash in, I should say. The very next fight, he goes back to Thailand, again in Muang Thong Thani, Thailand. And he beats someone, TKO4, Rodney June Alba, who's 11-6-2. And the line in his box rec says underneath it, Alba was controversially forced to fight Sarimonkul However, on his way to the official weigh-in, Alba was involved in a car crash, was hurt, and broke and cut his nose and forced to fight. I mean,
yeah. You want to tie
that? If already, that doesn't scream Thailand, boxing, I don't.
Let's tie it all in, Tim. Ready to get your mind blown? The editor that wrote that comment on BoxRec, Jeremy Lance, president of the American Boxing Federation, that Donna Bolanos will be fighting for that title this weekend in Sonora, Mexico. Boom! It's all tied in together, brother.
Oh, my God.
It's all tied in, baby.
Do you remember, I mean, speaking of, because I remember, so around the time that Saree Munkle, I guess it would have been a couple of years later, so Saree Munkle test positive for hepatitis. Do you remember Fasai Sakarian doing the same thing? I think it was before a fight in South Africa, but he got arrested for fraud. He faked his medical while having hepatitis. It was kind of like like Tommy Morrison denial of transmissible blood diseases kind of situation.
Wow. No, I do not remember this, but that,
yeah.
Was that before like
that's very bad.
Oh, damn. Is that before like a title fight too? Jesus.
I think so. I think it was like an IBO title fight or something like that. Yeah.
Damn.
And right on brand with Thailand, not going back too far, he fights four times in 2016. And this is just Thailand through and through. At this time, he's 90-2. And all four of his fights in 2016 are against four debutantes. Yep. And one of them by the name of Willie Whipple. And the chances of that person actually being named Willie Whipple, you know, one of us is about to be heavyweight champion if that guy was really Willie Whipple.
Here's the thing.
I mean, I hope his nickname was the Whipper.
He not only does he exist, but you can follow him on Instagram at Willie Whipple.
Cut the shit.
I'm not playing around, brother. He's a Muay Thai guy, it looks like. But he had one pro boxing match. So that's,
oh my God.
So Willie Whipple is real. He's an American living in
checkmate China. For BoxRec Ray on that one. Checkmate.
Yeah, boom. Yeah, I'm just blowing your mind here. Oh, by the way, also he's also Sing Wangcha is also starring in TV shows and movies in Thailand during this time. But right before he got arrested, I forgot to mention that. So he's actually kind of famous, like legitimately famous, like celebrity. So yeah, as Tim said,
Tim, by the way, Willie Whipple is friends with our man Sangartheet, the 17-year-old from Thailand that won like that minor WBC belt not that long ago.
I see that now. I'm a new follower of Willie Whipple. Gray, are you gonna get to the controversial juicy stuff, or are you just gonna leave that off the table?
Want me to read the broken English line on Wikipedia? Is that what you're asking me?
Well, I mean, there was an article about something. He was involved in some scantily clad pinups of some sort, apparently.
Do you want me just to read you the sentence verbatim on Wikipedia with all the grammatical errors? Because I don't know who wrote this, but wow. In 2005, he was scandalized by nude photo when police officers have detected a pornographic book for gay sold at the Ortor Core Market opposite some other market, which has his photos in those books as well. So apparently he did some modeling. And that was controversial. So, by the way, this is in an article written by Vice. The title of it is "The Comeback of Former Gay Pinup Drug Dealer and Boxing Champion," Sing Wangcha. So that's pretty wild. This guy's had a pretty fucking crazy life.
For all we know, the guy was probably in some tidy whitey underwears in a Sears catalog, and
exactly.
You know, it ended up in Wikipedia under that. But
yeah, whatever. But as Corey mentioned, he was supposed to fight Boo Boo, but he ends up getting outpointed in Singapore in a unanimous decision loss to a fighter named Azibek Abdugofurov. Am I fucking this name up? Probably.
Yeah. Abdugofurov. Yep. Yeah. You got it.
Oh, shit. He beat Fedor Chudinov last week? What? What in the world? He beat Fyodor Chudinov? I didn't even know Fyodor Chudinov was still fighting. This is incredible. I feel like
Lost.
Yeah, damn.
Saturday.
He's beaten both Chudinov brothers, and he's ranked top 15 at super middle. Man, this is all too much for me, guys. So he lost to Abdugafurov. So that was probably his chance at Boo Boo was blown. And then also he fought most recently Tewa Karam at fucking 175 pounds. The same guy who fought Matisse on HBO.
Yeah.
Got knocked out. That's awesome.
That was a great fight.
That was a great fight.
He also fought in Tanzania in 2020. That's not on his box rec.
Oh.
Okay. Shit. Who did he? It was Dula. He fought in Tanzania. Twaha Kaduku, who is a super, and they fought at super middleweight. In the fall of 2020, I know it's on my Twitter, and it was the strangest fight because the fight was really competitive, and then in the seventh or sixth round, somewhere in that range, Singwancha just basically turned around and just walked to his corner like, yeah, that's what I have for tonight, and the fight was over. It was done.
I mean, he knew it was never going on box rack. It never counted. Who cares?
He didn't give a shit. It's kind of
never
like,
happened.
It kind of reminds me how Bob Sapp fights these days. Like the paycheck's already cleared. He's giving you a minute 30. That's it. Like he's going down after that. That's awesome.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, he's fighting in Thailand bare knuckle this weekend at cruiserweight. So he is what a career, guys. 45 years old, now at cruiserweight, trying to keep his perfect bare knuckle record of 0-1 intact. So, what a salute to a true, like, combat sports legend. That's all I have to say. My God,
what a way to tie a bow on this episode.
Whew. Yeah. I know we need to wrap up here. I guess Canelo's fighting this weekend, so cool. Enjoy that one. But more importantly to my heart, Tim, there's a fight card in Florida. Once again, our friends at FITE, Fight TV, are going to be airing it. Anthony Martinez against David Light for the WBO International Cruiserweight title, 12-1 against 17-0. I think that could be potentially really good. And Lenny Perro, who is a really good amateur in Cuba, who just recently fought Giovanni Bruzon in an absolutely awesome fight on New Year's Day in Florida. He'll be back at it again against Hector Perez, who you may remember fighting the great Juan Torres. Shout out to Juan Torres for winning last week, by the way. He fought Juan Torres in the MGM Grand Bubble. So once again, a lot of our favorites colliding this weekend, Tim. So even if you have plenty of options outside of just Canelo, that's all I'll say.
So yeah, leave it to Fight TV to keep us busy on the stuff that we love. FITE.TV. And shout out to Warriors Boxing. I've been a big fan of Leon Margolis for a long time, and Melvin Rivas is the matchmaker. I'm looking forward to that show too. I always love to have the big pay-per-view up on my TV, and then I'll have Fight on my laptop, so I'll be looking forward to that one. Gray,
Corey, because you're part of, you know, yes, sir. You got ties to DAZN, my friend. What are you looking for? We got, you know, we should mention Canelo, I guess. You know, we poo-poo our noses the mainstream. Before we go, what are you looking forward to on this undercard? Is anything whetting your appetite?
Yeah, I mean, you get a look at the Uzbek marvel, Elnur Abdurayimov, who, you know, for the super hardcores, probably remember him as one of the more exciting guys on the amateur circuit over the last couple of years, just like an all action, pure aggression kind of guy who's facing Manuel Correa on the undercard. And also, I mean, Jalei Zhang's going to fight Scott Alexander. You know, Scott Alexander is our kind of guy, right? So he gets a look on main card DAZN. But I'll be calling the deep undercard. People who are interested, you can watch that for free, even if you don't tune in for the pay-per-view.
Watch the deep undercard.
I'll be on that one. So, yeah, so you can watch the deep undercard.
Watch the deep undercard.
We've got three Olympians on the deep undercard, don't we? Espino?
So Castro just got moved to the main broadcast now. Yeah, so now it'll be Abdurayimov, Fernando Angel Molina, and Joselito Velasquez is also on that on the deep undercard too, and then Alexis Espino and Aaron Silva. Alexis Espino, a slight betting underdog after suffering that that draw. So yeah, right now he is a plus 100 underdog last time that I checked.
It doesn't surprise me, Corey, because funny enough, I saw Aaron Silva's last fight, which was also available to bet on DraftKings, and he was an underdog in that bout and won. So I have a feeling that the guy, I have a theory that the guy who makes these, the guy who makes all the odds is the same odds maker. So I think he remembered both of those two guys' last fight. So kind of a smart line, I have to say. Because normally you would just kind of go for the, Espino's the matchroom guy. Make him the favorite. But I'm actually kind of like, no, I actually do think he should be the underdog in this fight. It's going to be a tough bout.
Yeah, and it's kind of like the atypical kind of pre-show fight, right? Where you might actually, like, there is the risk that the home fighter gets upset here, right? And it doesn't go on last on the pre-show or anything like that. It's just a well-matched fight for the sake of having a well-matched fight, which is pretty neat. So definitely to tune in early.
Before we go, this is the I don't know if the show is really happening, but it's on the BoxRec schedule department. 49-year-old Cornelius K9 Bundridge is supposed to fight in Michigan, guys. Just need to throw that out there. God bless, I guess. Is there anything else, Tim, that you just feel the itch to mention here?
There's so much more. So much more. But we'll just leave that. We'll leave it on the sidelines this week.
We'll leave it at that. I think my point is that you should be subscribing to Tim's newsletter and get all that supplementary information, because there's only so much we could talk about for an hour on this show. So I think it's time for Tim to go sit down and watch some hockey, and then I need to go make dinner. And I'm sure Corey has a real life unlike us, so it needs to get going. So first of all, let's graciously thank our guests for giving an hour of his time. Corey Erdman, we look forward to seeing you very busy this weekend behind commentary. Very happy to see you working, my friend. I know it's been a long couple of miserable years, it feels like, with COVID. So, buddy, I'm glad to see you back on the road. And where can we find you on social media and continue to follow your progress?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, you can also read my articles every Monday on Boxing Scene. I write the lead story there once a week on Monday. So you can catch those on there. And then you can follow me on Twitter at Corey_Erdman. And I'll let you know what I'm doing when I'm doing it on there. So follow me and you'll find out.
And Tim, in addition to buying from your merchandise store and following your newsletter, where can we find you?
At Tim Boxeo on Twitter, at Tim Boxeo 2.0 on Instagram. Go to timboxeo.substack.com to get signed up for the newsletter.
Yes.
And that's about it.
Join the Tim Boxeo Discord Nation. We also, Tim's been uploading these podcast episodes to his YouTube account. So we now have a YouTube home, because I'm too fucking lazy to do it myself. So shout out to Tim for picking up the slack there. My name is BoxRec Grey. You can find me at BoxRecGrey. Feel free to drop me a line at grey@boxrec.com. If you have any comments about the show, any questions, we'll always do a mailbag segment if you want a DM. But until then, guys, thanks for popping in. Enjoy the fights this weekend. Stay alive. Stay in one piece. Don't do fentanyl and come back. We'll be right here to keep you updated on the weird fringes of boxing. Unprofessional Boxing Podcast. Take care.